most of the 20th century, humanity has basked in its warm blue glow. Day after day, night after night, it has been a constant companion and trusted resource, a portal to other times, places, and ideas. From the very beginning, there were detractors. The mothers, the fathers, the teachers, the clergy, the press, the Amish, each uttering the same familiar phrase.
TV will rot your brain.
Rot your brain.
Absolutely. TV will rot your brain.
TV will rot your brain.
Everybody knows. TV will rot your brain.
Was it just a cliche? An old wives' tale? An urban myth? Was there any science to this claim? Could TV literally decay, decompose, degenerate, disintegrate, putrefy, wither, and waste the human brain?
There is no question that television has a physiological impact on the brain at the level of hurting the brain, deteriorating your mind activity. The mind turns into mashed potato.
Is it conceivable that this has been part of its purpose all along? And if so, who was behind it? And perhaps more importantly, why?
TV is a drug, right? It's crack. It's crystal meth squared, right? It's the worst thing in the world for your brain. And we've had it for 50 years, and it's pretty much kind of turned us into quasi-zombies.
The question is, what for? Just to sell us products? I don't think so. There's something deeper in this project.
Television as a plot to turn human gray matter into goo matter? On the surface, it seemed preposterous, the kind of far-flung conspiracy worthy of today's internet. But the clues were piling up long before, as far back as the very history of the medium itself. Three television channels became five. Five became 13. 13 became 300. And finally, the birth of 24-hour cable TV. Hundreds of channels filled with relaxed standards programming. Around-the-clock TV paired with the perfect way to sleep in front of it. Could those flickering blue rays be tampering with brain tissue even as people slept?
In 1977, Jerry Mander theorized on something called alpha waves, which is the type of brain activity induced onto the brain by television and is the effect of emotionless mind, a mind that is turned passive to the point of total incapacity to think.
Our children are going to grow up to be total mush-brained zombies. There's no hope for them.
The content kept on coming and the channels kept growing. Many beamed directly from space, culminating in the phenomenon dubbed reality TV, a scriptless, plotless, pointless, thoughtless, relentless genre that dished up all the experiences humans missed while sitting on their couches. Their lives. And yet, no one cared. Why go to the exhausting effort of living a life when you could absorb one on TV? Unless, of course, it was all part of a vast conspiracy. Decades in the making.
We've sort of submitted our judgment to the better judgment of television. Behind us is clearly a project. A project of control and domination, which sooner or later will be revealed in the form of physical domination.
Your parents were right, your teachers were right, even that creepy scoutmaster with the tight brown shorts was right. TV is slowly rotting your brain and turning it into a slimy, gooey, mushy blob of pudding, and there's nothing you can do about it.
Once your brain's reduced to a cottage cheese-like mush, we'll scoop them out with a melon baller and gobble them right on up.
Because we're aliens.
That's kind of our thing.
Could it be? Could every actor, director, producer, technician, boom mic operator, editor, makeup artist, PA, could everyone in this seemingly innocuous industry be playing a part in some sort of diabolical conspiracy? Absolutely.
And there's nothing you can do about it. See? I just told you what was happening, and you're still watching TV. Amazing.
Now you know. I'm Alec Baldwin. Enjoy the shows.
What are we gonna do about it? We're gonna do nothing about it. We're powerless in front of the square box. We're powerless in front of the apparatus. And to be honest with you, I wanna keep watching Biggest Loser.
The media conglomerate Hulu clearly designed this series of commercials to poke fun at the effect Hollywood has upon its masses. Although they're intending it to be humorous, there is an amount of truth in every joke, otherwise it wouldn't be funny. In Hulu's case, they put it right in front of your face, telling you exactly what prolonged exposure to television is doing to you, and then gloat in the fact that the average person will stay plugged in. The slogan in the commercial series is worth noting.
Hulu, an evil plot to destroy the world. Enjoy.
The world was first introduced to the advertisements of Hulu during the fourth quarter of the Super Bowl 43, when the most eyes would be fixed on every frame of the game. It was not put on in the middle of the night when no one would be watching. Is the health of our minds really at stake? Is there any substantial evidence to what Mr. Alec Baldwin is saying? As everyone knows, entertainment is totally fake, but can it actually have an adverse effect upon your life? And if so, could there really be a diabolical plan to use Hollywood for some deeper deception?
You know, with today's media bombardment, we have televisions in every location you can possibly imagine. People put them in cars, they're in grocery store lines. Everywhere you go, we are saturated with media. What is actually really happening inside your brain as you sit and stare at these blinking lights? And moreover, is there some sort of diabolical plan to destroy the world using this media? Not everything you see on television is considered evil. Not everything is damaging to you. But what kinds of things are good to watch and what kinds of things are bad to watch? What we hope to achieve is that you will be able to make better choices of what you allow into your mind based on this information. We decided to start at the beginning to see what the media's impact was upon toddlers. There are many studies bubbling to the surface why children should not watch television.
Hi everyone, a new study found that 40% of three-month-olds are regular TV watchers.
Would you believe that one-third of all three-year-olds in America have a TV in their bedrooms?
No, I can't believe it. Yeah, it's kind of disturbing. Did you know the average child spends nearly 45 hours a week watching TV or using other types of media, such as a computer? A report released today says this is having a negative impact on our children's health.
By the time they're toddlers, 90% are tuning in. That may be good news for the founders of a 24/7 channel for babies, but guess what? It's bad news for our kids.
Research gives parents more reason to keep infants and toddlers away from television.
Children need to interact with humans to develop healthy brains. And the Academy says children who watch 3 to 4 hours of non-educational TV every day will have seen almost 8,000 murders by the end of grade school. It doesn't take an Einstein, baby or otherwise, to understand what this means or to follow three little words of advice issued by the Academy.
It is time for toddlers and their parents to turn that TV off.
Turn it off.
You know, I think it's a misnomer to say that everything on TV is bad, is evil, has an agenda. In fact, it might be hypocritical for us to sit here and say that because obviously we work in production and we're creating this documentary. So we went back to the beginning to see how media affects the brain, more specifically children's brains. So we took a road trip up to Seattle to interview Dr. Dimitri Kasakis, in where he has spent the better half of 15 years researching the developing brain and while it's being influenced by television.
The concern I had was that exposing the developing brain to the rapid sequencing of television programs, particularly baby DVDs, which are more rapidly sequenced even than normal television, would precondition the mind to expect high levels of input. And that would lead to shorter attention spans later in life. Reality couldn't, if you will, keep pace with the expectations that had been created by watching too much fast-paced programming later in life. And we found just that the more television that babies watched before the age of three, the more likely they were to have attention problems later in life. Specifically, for each hour that they watched on a typical day before the age of three, their chances of having attentional problems were increased by about 10%. So to put that another way, a baby who watched 2 hours of TV a day before the age of three would be 20% more likely to have attentional problems at age seven compared to a child who watched none. And we followed that initial study up by looking at what children watched, because as you might imagine, not all shows are paced the same. And if our hypothesis was right, then the more fast-paced programs they watched, the greater their risk would be of having attentional problems. And that's exactly what we found. The more fast-paced programs they watched, the higher their risk. Slow-paced programs, particularly those that took place in real time, didn't appear to increase the risk at all. So that was part of a series of early studies looking into what I call the overstimulation hypothesis, that you can overstimulate the developing brain. So our work has progressed now to developing a mouse model of this. And if you will, we have what in effect is mouse television, and we expose newborn mice to overstimulation. We have them watch television, which is to say we have lights flashing and sound piped into their cage for about 6 hours a day, starting at 10 days of life through their childhood. And then we test their cognitive and behavioral development. And then what we find is that the overstimulated mice have shorter attention spans, are greater risk takers, and have poorer cognitive development than the normally reared mice.
Now, when we're talking about children and you're exposing, you know, or children are exposed to this, what age range are we really talking about? I mean, is there a difference between, you know, a five-year-old, six-year-old, or seven-year-old?
In 1970, the average age at which children began to watch television regularly was 4 years of age. And today, it's closer to 4 months of age. And that rapid shift hasn't occurred so much over the last 40 years as it has over the last 15 years. There were no products that were aimed at children that young prior to about 15 years ago. So the advent of baby DVDs and all of their claims of making children smarter, more musical, more mathematical, have really successfully gotten parents to put their babies in front of the television. And because babies' brains are very much a work in progress, the effects of baby TV are very different than the effects of preschool television. And if we have a conversation about preschool television, you'll hear me say very, very different things. Because although I'm a firm believer that TV exposure before the age of two should really be minimized, after the age of two, there are programs which, if used appropriately, don't pose any risk to children at all. In fact, have been shown in many studies to proffer benefit.
At a TED conference, Dr. Christakis showed that not every media production that is labeled educational is necessarily beneficial.
Which brings us to Baby Einstein. Now, many of you probably have not seen Baby Einstein, but I will show you a random 20-second clip from Baby Einstein Day on the Farm, and here it is. In that 20-second clip, there were seven scene changes, about one every 3 seconds. It's about the most exhausting day on the farm since John Steinbeck's Grapes of Wrath. And of course, it's nothing like being on a real farm, right? Adults watching this find it discombobulating because your mind is trying to make a coherent narrative out of this, and there is no coherent narrative. It jumps all over the place. But babies aren't trying to make a coherent narrative out of it. They're not capable of doing that. It's all of that screen change, all of that stimulation that's keeping them actually engaged in the screen. So we've had for a while what we call the overstimulation hypothesis, which is that prolonged exposure to this rapid image change during this critical window of brain development would precondition the mind to expect high levels of input, and that would lead to inattention in later life. So you watch enough Baby Einstein Day on the Farm as a baby, and when you go to a farm as a school-aged child, it's boring. It's too slow. How come there's no sheep suddenly popping into my face? How come there's no marionette going back and forth? Why do I have to walk from here to there? That's the general idea, that you're conditioning the mind to that reality, which doesn't actually exist.
Is there a danger to exposing the mind to realities that don't really exist? If you just observe a small child at play, you'll notice that they're very active in their play, they're very animated. When you take that same child and you place them in front of the television, that activity stops. The same thing takes place in the mind. Parts of the mind simply stop. Watching television is a passive activity. You're not interacting with what you're seeing. A child's mind, to develop properly, needs to interact with the world around them, needs to interact with people especially. When you're born with billions of brain cells and trillions of connections can be made. By the age of 3, you have twice as many synapses as you do as an adult. I mean, think about it. Kids are constantly learning. They're interacting with their environment, and this is what's needed for proper brain development. The pathways haven't been formed yet. And as these pathways formed, as the child interacts with the world around them, interacts with the people around them, each time a neuron fires, there's a protein sheath that's laid down over the axon of the neuron. The myelinating of the neurons in the mind strengthens those neurons and strengthens those pathways. Between the ages of 6 and 7, there's an enzyme that's released into the brain that dissolves all poorly myelinated pathways. So any neuron that hasn't been used or hasn't been formed into a pathway and doesn't have a thick myelin sheath, it's dissolved, it's pruned, as it were. When you place children in front of television, there's no interaction, there's no real life movement or anything with what they're actually seeing. This situation has caused the American Pediatrics Association to recommend that children under the age of 2 should never be exposed to television. France has even taken it a bit further and said any child under the age of 3 should not be exposed to television, and has made it illegal to produce programming geared towards that age group. So what happens when you're an adult? When you're watching television, you're essentially staring at a blinking light, much like the mice in Christakis' experiment. If you've ever experienced a mind fog after watching television, you're not alone. The brain has 4 modes that it operates in, 4 brainwave patterns. Delta is when you're deep asleep, theta is when you're in light sleep, alpha is awake but relaxed. It's the mode of thinking that you are in when you're in the most heightened state of suggestibility. And then there's beta, the highest functioning mode, like when you're reading a book or you're having a very stimulating conversation. In 1969, Herbert Krugman did a study where he found that in less than 60 seconds, the human brain switched from beta brainwave patterns, those exhibited during logical thought, to alpha brainwave patterns. Alpha is not a bad brainwave pattern to be in, but when you're in that brainwave pattern a lot of the time, and if you look at the averages of how much people are watching television, this just leaves the mind unfocused and unable to concentrate.
Researchers have said that watching television is similar to staring at a blank wall for several hours. Robert Kuby did a study which appeared in Scientific America in 2002.
Looking at how people experienced television in the flow of their everyday life. And we used a beeper technology where we would beep people at intervals, and they would write down what they were doing, how they were feeling, and so on. And I was able to look at this stuff, and I was able to show and demonstrate like what kinds of days people experienced when they would watch more at night. And the answer to that was they felt not very good at work. They had a really bad day at work. I found that people who didn't have a good tolerance for what I called unstructured time watched more TV. And I would say this is probably true for use of the internet too. If you don't feel comfortable with yourself and you need to fill up that time when you're by yourself and you don't have anything else to do, then what are you going to do? You're going to gravitate to the easiest, most inexpensive medium that was ever invented, which is virtually free, television, and fill up your mind with something else. So it's a kind of form of escapism.
The effects of television on the mind are probably one of the most studied aspects of our society. And one of the things that takes place in the mind is that the frontal lobe is being bypassed. Within minutes of sitting down and watching television, the frontal lobe activity simply goes almost to nothing.
The frontal lobe of the brain is the seat of spirituality, morality, and the will. It's actually the analytical portion of our brain, and it's actually the decision maker. And so it's a crucial aspect in regards to our future success and happiness is how well our frontal lobe is functioning. And unfortunately, entertainment television suppresses the frontal lobe of the brain. actually in about 90 seconds of viewing it, the frontal lobe circulation begins to go down, and it actually has an adverse effect. And you know, the interesting thing is people watch entertainment television often due to the fact that they feel a little depressed or anxious and it kind of calms them. But in reality, it's a very short-term fix and it's going to complicate things in the long run. Of course, I'm most known for the one who treats depression and anxiety. In fact, we treat the most severe forms of depression and anxiety. And what we have found is virtually every depressed patient will have about a 40% decrease in circulation and activity of the frontal lobe of the brain. And so we're trying to enhance the frontal lobe. And so, you know, unfortunately, you know, a lot of these gadgets that produce this overstimulation, they can be fun for the short term. But, you know, there's more fun things to do than ever before in human history, but yet we have more depression than ever before in human history, more anxiety. Mental health problems are skyrocketing throughout the world. And the entertainment medium is one of the primary reasons why this is occurring. Studies will clearly demonstrate that when you go to entertainment as a way to either get fun and it becomes a habitual process, the risk of depression and anxiety will more than double.
So we decided to drive down to LA and to talk to a top neurologist and find out really what's happening with the frontal lobe when we watch television.
Well, each hemisphere has a prefrontal cortex. And it is, depending on how you measure it, 30 to 33% of the human neocortex. It has many functions which are often discussed in terms of cognition as executive abilities. I like to summarize it by having a role that you'd expect from a chief executive officer of a corporation, making strategic decisions, monitoring the performance of those activities, making corrections en route, and so on. It's also the source of social behavior. It turns out that humans are particularly visual animals. A lot of the information that is required for relating to the environment is visual. And so a lot of the posterior part of the neocortex is devoted to complex visual processing beyond the primary visual cortex. So that I think of it as a gradual reconstruction. What you see is not necessarily a carbon copy of reality. What you see is a gradual coding and reconstruction of the signal in neurologic terms. And in that process, a lot of interpretation goes on.
So Dr. Mendez says that the frontal lobe is like our command center. It's like where we make all these executed decision-making processes. That our perception of reality is based upon what we basically take in through our visual cortex. Now, question, could you change someone's reality based on what you give them visually to watch? Dr. Michael Rich, a media expert from Boston's Children's Hospital, wrote an article about what happens in your brain when you sit down and you watch a 3D movie, and here's what he says. So what does your brain do when it's sitting in a theater looking at a giant screen wearing 3D glasses and swimming in surround sound, processing 24 images that flip by per second? Your brain dutifully processes those stimuli and does little else. In fact, your prefrontal cortex, which is involved in impulse control, future thinking, and moral choices, is basically inactivated during this process. That is why you get lost in a movie. Also, researcher Jacob Jacoby found after testing 5,400 viewings that 83% of those viewers misunderstood or miscomprehended that which they watched only moments before. That's what happens when the prefrontal cortex or the frontal lobe is shut off.
You know, one of the interesting things about educational TV, you know, for instance, C-SPAN is educational TV. It may not be the greatest education, but it's one camera view and there's a senator up there giving a talk and giving a lecture. And you'll see something happen when you're in a room. You know, being a doctor, there's a doctor's lounge at the hospital I'm at. And often doctors look for educational TV when they're there together. And you will see them stand up and begin to vehemently argue against the television set. Because they'll say, you know what, he left this out. He left that out. He's not mentioning this. This is a very biased presentation. You will never see anyone argue with their television set when entertainment television is going on. You will see them actually just sitting there, accepting all this, maybe laughing or crying, but they're not going to argue with the set because they don't have the ability. They may vehemently disagree with what's going on that program, but they have no ability to actually bring forward that disagreement and start to logically go through the arguments in their mind because of the suppression of the frontal lobe of their brain.
Furthermore, research has shown that the limbic system cannot tell the difference between something that is real and not real. That's a job for the frontal lobes or the prefrontal cortex, which is virtually shut off, remember? So what happens is your limbic system then reacts to television or a movie as if it's real. It releases the appropriate hormones of the fight or flight system in conjunction with the stresses that it places upon the body.
So the advertising industry knows full well what it's doing and how to most effectively sell their product to you. In fact, they spend billions of dollars every year to psychologically manipulate you into buying their product. And they do it with military precision. Here's an example. Procter & Gamble spent $13.6 billion in 2011 in advertising. And L'Oreal spent almost $5 billion. And General Motors topped it off with $3.5 billion. So if you think about it, if we're not truly affected by what we watch or hear, these companies wouldn't spend billions of dollars. Just to give you an idea of how much money this really is, LA Times in 2008 wrote an article on how to solve world hunger. Within this article, they wrote that the price of hunger was estimated at $30 billion per year to solve the world hunger problem.
TV advertising works. It works really well. And we're spending millions of dollars on it to promote, ironically, an online brand.
But advertising is not all just about money. They're there to sell you a set of ideas with those products. You see, marketers understand something. They understand that the key to marketing is your emotional attachment.
For us, the art of marketing is about creating emotional responses. And I mean, that's the whole idea of art, right? It's why you go to a museum. It's why art influences, inspires us. And applying that to marketing is something we've always thought, you know, very heavily about. It's about bringing design, bringing emotion and creativity and passion.
I mean, you can play this game with yourself. Just say Coca-Cola or Ford or Boeing. Just name anything like that, and then start ticking off what you associate with it.
Right.
There'll be a whole bunch of attributes, and those attributes are created in advertising. They're created by the product itself. They're created by the experience you have if you call the company with a problem or no problem. Any interaction you have with that product, company, thing that it makes, service, the cumulative effect, the cumulative impression you have is the brand.
How you feel about a certain product, how it feels in your hand, how you feel when you wear those clothes or whatever they're selling you is exactly what marketers are going for.
Advertising is the art of the intelligent generalization, okay? It's not supposed to be a tech sheet. It's supposed to get across the gestalt, the essence of the idea. It's supposed to turn you onto an idea of the product and what your relationship is going to be with this product or service, not all the specifics.
Who in this room has ever bought something they didn't really need? Yeah? Okay, some people have got two hands up. So you're standing in front of it and you're going, I don't need it, can't afford it, it's not practical, and you walk out with it. Why? Because of the emotion it makes you feel to buy it. My favourite business writer, and I'm sure some of you share this, is a guy called Tom Peters. Now, I was reading an interview he did with an executive from Harley Davidson. So he's interviewing their top executive. And he said, halfway through the interview, yeah, but you just sell motorbikes. And the executive said, Tom, you have missed the point. He said, we don't sell motorbikes. And Tom Peters says, well, what do you sell? He said, we sell the ability for a 43-year-old accountant to dress in black leather, drive through a small country town, and have people be afraid of him. He said, we sell an emotion. We sell a feeling. He said if you use logic to buy a motorbike, you'd buy a Japanese one because they're awesome.
Notice the key word is feeling, your emotional attachment to them.
How society became an emotionally driven market really began in the 1920s with Sigmund Freud's nephew, Edward Bernays.
Eddie Bernays saw the way to sell product was not to sell it to your intellect that you ought to buy an automobile, but that you will feel better about it if you have this automobile. I think he originated that idea, that they weren't just purchasing something, but they were engaging themselves emotionally or personally in the product or service. But it's not, you think you need a new piece of clothing, but you'll feel better with the piece of clothing. That was his contribution in a very real sense. We see it all over the place today, but I think he originated the idea of the emotional connect to a product or service.
He was almost single-handedly responsible for the way our modern society shifted from a needs-based society to a wants-based society. He took his uncle's writings about human desire and applied them to the masses. You see, at this time, American corporations enjoyed a massive boom in production because of the war, and goods poured off the production lines. But what they feared was a danger of overproduction. There would be a point where people had enough goods and would simply stop buying. Goods had been marketed to the masses on the basis of need and function. Things like shoes, stockings, and cars were promoted in functional terms for their durability. What the corporations realized they had to do was to transform the way that the majority of Americans thought about the products. One leading Wall Street banker, Paul Mazur of Lehman Brothers, was clear about what was necessary. He said, "We must shift America from a needs to a desires culture. People must be trained to desire and to want things even before the old had been entirely consumed. We must shape a new mentality in America. Man's desires must overshadow his needs."
Prior to that time, there was no American consumer. There was the American worker, and there was the American owner, and they manufactured, and they saved, and they ate what they had to, and the people shopped for what they needed. And while the very rich may have bought things they didn't need, most people did not. And Mazur envisioned a break with that, where you would have things that you didn't actually need, but you wanted, as opposed to needed.
You see, the way advertising works is by creating a void in your self-worth that only the product or service can fill. Manner sold the idea that looking cool is actually better than functionality. And in the same way, women are sold the idea that external beauty is paramount over personality and character. The most glaring example of this can be seen inside the beauty industry. The Dove Corporation recognizes this and has created an entire campaign exposing the onslaught of advertising focused on external beauty. This particular commercial shows what a young girl sees in magazines, on mannequins, and in advertisements, which will ultimately have a significant impact upon her self-worth. This industry has mastered the art of lying about true beauty, and the only way to have it is to utilize their products. Dove ends the commercial with wise advice. Talk to your daughter before the beauty industry does.
New research has opened up the door for marketers to take a peek into our brains. It's called neuromarketing. For the first time in human history, we are able to monitor a live view of the working parts of one of the most mysterious organs in the human body. Now marketers are even using medical technology called an fMRI. And what they're doing is basically being able to peek into your brain and see real time your emotional response to anything.
Canadian scientists are part of a great exploration, accessing parts of the brain never before reached, investigating what motivates behavior. In her first piece tonight, our health reporter Kelly Crow introduces us to a branch of advertising born out of this emerging research, one that is raising alarm bells.
It's cutting-edge neuroscience at a shopping mall.
How's that feel?
That's good.
Denham Drew has volunteered to let researchers watch his brain activity while he shops. They measure the electrical impulses on the surface of his brain and use computer software to translate those brain waves into emotional states.
The fuchsia is instantaneous excitement.
These eye-tracking goggles will record everything he looks at. When they analyze the data, the researchers believe they will know how he really felt about shoes without asking him.
So how's he feeling right now?
Right now, very engaged in what he's looking at.
As modern brain imaging allows scientists to map complex neural networks inside the living brain, a new field is emerging using neuroscience to sell things.
We don't measure what you think, we measure how you feel.
But what if they could see into the brain, bypass the conscious mind, and read a customer's true emotional response in real time?
His engagement has gone up pretty steadily.
The theory, if advertisers learn what's going on at the brain's more primitive emotional level, they can better predict what consumers will do.
You compare where he's looking with what he's feeling, and you're really seeing inside his head.
It's really giving you a lot of insight into his emotional response.
Western University neuroscientist Ruth Lanius says in theory the data could be used to manipulate consumer behavior.
Of course you can influence the brain, right? And so
an advertiser might be able to do this to an unsuspecting consumer?
Possibly, yeah.
Is that something we should be worried about?
I think it's something that definitely has ethical implications that need to be reviewed and discussed.
This is Taking Stock on Bloomberg. I'm Pim Fox. Smart marketers, as I said, they don't really guess about what consumers are doing. They use neuromarketers. I want to introduce Martin Lindstrom. He is the author of the new book, Biology, Truth and Lies About Why We Buy.
I think with all my work, my previous six books, I sort of proved that we can go very far. We can use manipulation to an extent where really the consumer sometimes do not have a fair chance to survive. So I think my duty is to put that line in the sand and say, hey, isn't it time for us now to just look at ourselves first, to create our own personal ethical guidelines, not the company's, but my personal guidelines, and then start to live against that. Because what will happen in the future is that everyone on the net, which basically is everyone in the world soon, will become a brand, and they will market themselves as a brand. And I think that every person now needs to say, how far am I willing to go in order to sell, so I'm not selling out? So lots of my work has been to say, here are the tools. It's up to you if you want to use them. Neuromarketing is really like a hammer. You can use that to hammer a nail into the wall and hang up a beautiful painting. Or you can use it to hammer someone in the head, which is not that good. So I'm really giving people the chance to use the hammer. Then I'm, in my last book, talking a lot about how far some companies are going, which in my opinion, going far too far, if you could say that.
Some marketers go to great lengths to manipulate consumers, such as what Ryan Holiday did to promote the movie I Hope They Serve Beer in Hell.
I've manufactured controversies, done stunts, planted fake stories. So for Tucker, one of the big things we did was, it was a movie primarily for young adult males. There are obviously people who don't like those types of movies. So instead of sitting back and saying, okay, we're not gonna be able to reach those people, they're a non-entity in this campaign, we thought, like, how can we get those people to denounce the movie and talk about it and spread the word about it in a way that makes young adult males want to go see whatever they're saying that they shouldn't go see? And so part of the campaign involved buying really controversial, deliberately provocative billboards that I went out and vandalized and then leaked photos of to blogs, real protests generated from my fake stunt to the degree in which the Washington Post, the Chicago Tribune both wrote editorials denouncing the movie. The city of Chicago banned our advertisements.
Manipulation is a common tool for advertisers, but it's not the only trick that they use. Television commercials are not only key to the success of those products or services, but they're also highly entertaining. Understanding how television commercials work isn't terribly complicated, but if you look very closely, you can start to see some of these tricks that marketers use to sell you their products. Take, for instance, the absurd. Like in this Amico Auto Insurance company, there's obviously no room for that many people to fit into that car. But what they're telling
you... You wouldn't choose a car that didn't fit your needs.
Turn on the car. Where's Liam?
Is that if you choose any other insurance company, you are almost as absurd as trying to fit that many people in the car. The testimonial.
Every day, thousands of people are choosing Advil. Here's one story.
My name is Blaine.
I use it, therefore you should use it. Then there's the fantasy. If you have this product,
Your dream will come true. You'll be the guy that gets the girl. Mr. Sandman, bring me a dream. Bum, 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 bum. Make him the cutest that I've ever seen. Bum, 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 bum. One of the most common tricks that they use is sex and humor. Why sex and humor? Why do they sell a car with a beautiful girl? Why do they make beer commercials to be so funny? Because everybody equates laughter with pleasure, or sexuality with pleasure.
Yeah, thanks for introducing us.
Anything for a friend.
Ooh, strong grip. Ow! So, you want to grab a bite somewhere?
Here's fine.
Oh no, oh no.
So they're pushing your pleasure buttons and then showing you their product. So we decided to look into this whole use of sexuality in marketing, and we came across a guy named Dr. Paul Zak, who's a neuroeconomist down in Southern California. We decided to pay him a visit. He spent the last decade of his life studying a hormone in your brain called oxytocin. It is the hormone that is released when a woman has just given birth to a baby, and it's what forms the bond between the mother and the child. Marketing researchers have looked into his research to see how can they release oxytocin in your brain when they show you these commercials.
And we discovered that this hormone called oxytocin facilitates trust between strangers. Because when someone trusts you, your brain releases this and it motivates you to reciprocate, to be trustworthy. So this led us into a variety of studies where we both measured and manipulated oxytocin in the human brain to figure out why we had so much trust between strangers. So since we've done that, we started looking at trust in other things, like in people you don't know, politicians, the government, advertisers. So for advertising, we asked this question, which is, why are there puppies in toilet paper commercials? Puppies don't use toilet paper, they have nothing to do with toilet paper. Unless you're really out of toilet paper, you might use the puppy. So what's going on with that? So we all know intuitively that advertisers want to grab our emotions. They want to engage us in this product. They want us to trust them, to trust this product. So we started thinking that maybe this has something to do with oxytocin. So let me describe an experiment we ran to test that. So we had an experiment where we had people view public service advertisements, like don't drive drunk, here's what can happen to you. And we put half the people in the experiment on oxytocin and half on placebo. So we can infuse oxytocin into your brain through your nose and oxytocin will get into your brain. What we found is that when oxytocin was raised, that is when you're in this trusting state, this empathic state, people did say they cared about the people in the commercials more. And more tellingly to me, when we gave them an option to donate money to these different causes, people on oxytocin donated more of their own money that they earned for this experiment to these particular causes. So it seems like advertisers have figured out how to get our brains to release oxytocin and make us trust, want, identify with their project. Things like during a wedding, we measured oxytocin during wedding vows recently, and the bride had a 28% increase in her oxytocin, the groom had an increase, family members had an increase. So we have this chemical that below our conscious awareness is bonding us together as a human family. And so it plays on a variety of the things that we see on TV and in movies. So an example of that is we developed a 100-second video of a father and his son who's 4 years old, who has terminal brain cancer. And this video is extraordinarily compelling. If you don't cry when you see it, you're not a human being. We found a 47% increase on average in oxytocin levels for people who would just watch that movie. And then we gave them an option to earn some money. And they could earn money either by keeping it for themselves or by offering it to another person to share it with them. And people who are empathically engaged, who had high oxytocin, in fact, shared much more money with a stranger. So all of a sudden, in a real tangible way, once we are engaged by this chemical, we are reaching out, and we're reaching out with our wallets.
It's common knowledge that people are able to memorize things better by the use of music. That's why young preschoolers are encouraged to learn their ABCs by singing a song. At the end of a lot of these commercials, you hear a ding or a dong.
You are now free to move about the country.
They use little songs and jingles to get you to remember their products. Television commercials have mastered the art of hypnotic induction.
And there's all kinds of examples of them poking fun at the use of using hypnosis.
Time to retrain your brain.
Retrain your brain. Retrain your brain.
Retrain your brain.
Order the phones you want. Get one or eight.
4G LTE.
Unlimited.
It's time to switch to 4G mobile.
So we decided to go and visit a couple clinical hypnotherapists and see what happens inside your brain while being hypnotized.
It's a real simplistic form of what NLP is, what hypnosis is. Initially, hypnosis was called monoideism by James Braid, which means one idea. Get it down to one idea so you have leverage. And that's what we're doing. We'll find out these anchor points with people, whether it's the feeling that we can change or it's the images in your head. Same thing with NLP. You basically learn about how the senses take in information, which they do, all five senses take information, and then we do a process that's called distorting, deleting, and generalizing that information. So what we see is actually what our brain is interpreting in the back of our head, in our cortex, visual cortex, and that shifts and changes. George Miller, back in the 50s, did some testing with how much information we can take in consciously and hold at one time. And I'll give you a guess, a phone number is approximately the digits. They call it 7 ± 2 bits of information that you can hold onto at one time. So if you start going into a telephone number, but then going into the area code, sometimes you'll stutter a little bit because you've got now new bits of information. People say it varies, but then the unconscious mind, the part that takes care of if you get a cut that you don't have to think about, it heals up by itself, that grows hair, that grows fingernails, that blinks your eyes, that gets you to swallow, those are all unconscious processes. So there's something taking in millions, if not billions, of bits of information and making them into information to make your body move, to make it breathe, to heal, to put you to sleep, try to stay awake too long. Sooner or later, your body's gonna take over and make you go to sleep. Try not to swallow for too long. Your body's gonna make you swallow. So we have a conscious crossover where we can adjust these things and play with them. But ultimately, because of safety and us staying alive and our body wanting us to stay alive, these other safety factors take over, even though we want to do it. So what they'll do with hypnosis, and this is where people become susceptible to it, is they'll overwhelm you with information. So you look at a commercial and you see all this information that comes all in at one time. And you see this goofy stuff and you go like, what is going on there? So what you've just done now is go into a questioning part of your mind. You've got a ton of new information and you're trying to figure out what it is. So they want to get you into an emotion. You think about the commercial. Does the commercial get you an emotion? Not really. They rely on the TV show to get you into the emotion. The cliffhanger, they go right to break and you go, oh wow, I can't wait, it's going to be over. The commercial comes on, you're in state, Pavlov's dog, remember, ringing the bell, the dog salivating, and then all of a sudden they got this new information that comes in. And the information is meant in to get you into using that state that you're now in, that curiosity, that cliffhanger, that anxiety, so to speak, of what's going to happen next, and associate their product with it.
So it's an easy thing to slip into trance. People do it on their own lots of times. Like if they're driving a route, it's real routine for them to do, easy time to go into trance. Or even more so if they're listening to music, like very rhythmic music, like rap music, which is actually almost dangerous to listen to for our young people because of the messages in it, and it's repeated in a hypnotic rhythm.
Which brings me to the use of rap music in commercials.
The all-wheel drive Suzuki Kizashi. Upgrade your ride.
It's also known as one of the most hypnotic forms of music and is used as background music to a lot of different commercials. The same thing applies to very rhythmic techno music. Remember, laughter releases endorphins and you think pleasurably about their product.
Is that my wedding dress?
It could be.
Even this wanting system, even the kind of MTV quick cut movies films are done on like for commercials now, that's really attention getting for the brain. It's just hard to look away. So all those techniques are using brain science essentially to suck you in.
You look at commercials, you look at MTV and the music videos, they're going 100 miles an hour. You can't get that. But let's go back to 7 plus or minus 2. You can't get it consciously, but you got it unconsciously, especially through the eyes. The ears have a certain range you can't really get past, and the mechanical part of the ears don't let in. That's one of the things where they said subliminal stuff, subliminal audios, they're using this. If you're, the mechanism can't hear it, it can't hear it. But visually, you can see a lot. And the amount of information that's out there that gets in that we're not aware of, foreground and background.
It's rewarding. So your brain is set up so that new information is encoded as a reward, because new information might be valuable to you. More resources here, more mates here, fresh water. So you get information flow, you got to pay attention to that. So, you know, we're acutely attuned to new information. So anything, so commercials are set up as new information. And they do provide some information, right? It's just not unbiased information.
Yeah, well, you got the Super Bowl. I mean, you think about the Super Bowl, they're paying how much? $3.8 million, maybe more, for a commercial. So people are in a state. A lot of people are betting money. They're gambling. We're not only just getting into emotions, we're going into the thinking centers of the brain. When you get into that anxiety and that you're running that, you get into the lower parts, the reptilian or the mammalian, the squirrel brain, as they call it. You're not into the higher cortex making decisions. So that's the game that we're playing with advertisers. That's the game we're playing with television, is to get people into and keep them into the lower brain centers, because they're much more easily controlled.
If you're measuring brain waves, the alpha state, we're in beta right now, the alpha state, which is what you want. Well, you're not in a trance in any of those last two states, only in the alpha. I'm not aware of anyone who can't be hypnotized. If you do your own, put yourself in trance, then anybody can be in trance. There are people who are more reluctant to be directed into trance, what some people will call resistant, and therefore unhypnotizable, but I'm not aware of anyone who's unhypnotizable. I've never read about anyone being unhypnotizable. That the skill often lies in the language used to hypnotize the person, permitting them to allow it to happen. Because I say, all hypnosis is self-hypnosis, whether I'm directing it or you're doing it to yourself. Just in what I witness on TV and magazines and products that you purchase, there's advertising on all of it. The language is structured such that it encourages you to buy. So it's very powerful stuff, because the language is much more subliminal, and people aren't paying attention to what they're hearing in the ad because they're just so caught up in the visuals. But if you listen carefully to the language used, it's very action-inducing language.
We'll take two chicken pot pies.
If I'm gonna go out and get it right now at 11 o'clock at night, you will tomorrow for lunch, or at least for dinner the next day, or sometime this week. You're going to Carl's Jr. or Kentucky Fried Chicken because of the way it's spoken about and presented. Print ads are very, very similar. I'm sure you've seen the research where the subliminal messages were buried in the wine glass and that kind of thing. Yeah, and they're really there too. So people don't realize that they're picking that up, but neurologically they are picking it up.
So there's great debate on subliminal advertising and if it actually works. I was actually shocked at the research that's been done and the investigation that's been done, how effective it really is. In fact, it's highlighted quite extensively in the book Biology by the author Martin Lindstrom.
Subliminal advertising. Everyone maybe thinks that is over and done with. It's been banned. True?
No, not true. Invented in 1956, it was banned across the world in 1957. Guess what? No one dared to touch it, except me, of course, because that's what we did in biology. We basically decided to scan people's brains as they're exposed to subliminal advertising. One of the companies in the world was the best at doing that is companies within the tobacco industry. It's been banned for 20 years to advertise for it, yet still the sales is going up around the world. And what we learned is it is incredibly powerful. You know, one example is, for example, we took a billboard and we put a cowboy on the billboard, no brand name next to it. Then we had the same billboard this time with a brand name on, and you can guess which brand it is. We had 600 smokers passing by. We scanned their brains. Guess what? The billboard without the logo were double as powerful as the one with the logo, and that's the first time ever we're proving that subliminal advertising actually works.
So in his book, Lindstrom writes about this experiment they did where they hooked people up to the fMRI machine, and then they let them view anti-smoking commercials. And what they found was the people that watched the anti-smoking commercials, their desire actually increased to actually want to smoke. People are actually using hypnosis now to quit smoking.
Well, now to something else that to many may seem too good to be true. A one-time, two-hour therapy session that enables you to quit smoking for good. It involves a type of hypnotism, but it's not what you might think.
What they're doing is they're taking a negative emotion and they're attaching it to your subconscious. The science on how you attach a negative emotion to an action is through hypnosis through language, or NLP, neuro-linguistic programming.
Well, the best way to describe NLP is to, first of all, define the language. The N stands for neuro, which is the neurological way that you take in information through your five senses. So that comes in through your neurology, goes into your brain, and the way you get that back out again is the L part of NLP, which is the linguistics. And the linguistics are the language. So all of us have a way of talking about what's going on inside of us. And then the P part stands for programming.
And basically it goes back to like Pavlov with the dogs, stimulus and response, but very crafty ways of doing stimulus and response. You know, we think of a noise and then a stimulus and then the response, the dog salivating.
Darren Brown is a master of hypnosis and NLP. He has made countless videos for entertainment purposes on how he's used those techniques to get people to do what he wants them to do. So in this example, Darren Brown convinces actor Simon Pegg to take a different gift than he originally wanted through the use of NLP.
Excellent. So, we spoke on the phone a few days ago.
Yes.
And I asked you to write down something you'd like for your birthday.
Yes.
I also asked you to sign the back of it when I spoke to you and gave you these instructions so that basically when you brought it with you today, which I hope you have done, you know that no one's going to steam it open or switch it or do anything with it.
Absolutely.
All kept secret?
Very much so.
Excellent. All right. Well, I have bought you a present. Now, don't get overexcited. It is in the big box behind you.
Right.
Right. It may be a small present in a big box.
Right.
Or it may be a big present in a big box.
Okay.
The size of the box will not necessarily give you any clues.
Sure.
All right. When you walk into a shop and you see something that you know you have to have, mm-hmm. what is that feeling like? Describe it for me.
I guess it's quite sort of sudden and you sort of, you have a definite positivity about it. And often you'll go away and see other things, but then you come back to the thing you saw first. And
excellent.
It's like, you know.
Well, just take that feeling. And just sort of amplify it a bit for me, because it is a really good feeling. It's okay. Important to understand that feeling of positivity that
sure.
you describe. Okay. And also, very nice to meet you, and thank you for coming on the show. Let me explain to you how I buy gifts or presents for people, all right? And this is the best way to handle, bar none, the problem of, you know, what to settle for when you're going to buy gifts for somebody that's a little bit difficult to buy for, all right? Now, what I do is rather than recycle the same sort of two tired bottles of wine or box of chocolates, which are no fun to receive, I go out and I buy anything, and then I make that person fall in love with it, all right, by creating a strong feeling of desire for that object. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah. And it absolutely works. They get all sort of pumped up, you know, they get that feeling of that positivity you were describing. They beam excitement for it. And, you know, it's a win-win thing because they get a present that they love and, you know, I get rid of some stuff out the back of my kitchen cupboard or whatever. What I want you to really understand about this is that that feeling is so strong, can be so extreme that it can replace the memory of what they actually wanted. So even though 2 days before they may have said, I want X, whatever that is, you know, like a really nice car, like a BM or an Xbox or something like that, something they really wanted, suddenly now they think they always wanted what I got them. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Yeah, yes. Excellent, cool. Good, so you can have anything you like. What's your dream present?
The BMX bike.
A BMX bike?
Yes.
That'd be fantastic.
NLP is so effective in the fact that it can change someone's mind just by using certain keywords and physical gestures.
Are you sure? If you think back, are you sure you're right? BMX bike is what you want. That absolutely feels right, doesn't it? When you think about what you want?
Yeah, absolutely, because
yes?
that's what I wrote down, and
yeah.
that's why I'm so flabbergasted that it's there.
Take it out, have a look. No one's touched this, have they? Where's it been? Where's it been since you wrote it?
It's been in my wallet.
In your wallet. Go on, have a look.
No, even. I'm shaking.
Let's just have a look at the back. You know, you signed your name across it. This is the date and the time.
It was 1:10 on Saturday.
1:10 last Saturday,
yeah.
Okay. But genuinely, you haven't, no one's touched this since you wrote it.
No, because I signed it over here, so you couldn't do it.
Let's just have a look. What's it say?
Leather jacket.
Leather jacket. Did you want leather jacket?
No, I wanted a BMX.
So why did you write leather jacket?
I didn't.
You didn't write leather jacket. That's your handwriting.
That's my handwriting as well.
This is what you want.
This is what I want, yeah.
Right. Any idea why you wrote that?
No.
That gives you that feeling of
yes.
Spontaneous positivity. Yes. That. Yes? Not yes. This. You don't want no. That. That's useless to you.
Absolutely.
So you're happy with your present? As am I. Congratulations and happy birthday. Right.
If there's some kind of thing going on that you know I can work out logically, I'm gonna play along and but I'm stunned. That's definitely my right, and that's my J. And I've got no need for a leather jacket, and I don't know what's going on.
Our brains work much like a computer. You can actually override the operating system and reprogram the brain. That's how powerful it is, and this is scientific fact. Hypnosis is as powerful as a drug. People have used it to stop smoking, to lose weight, to have pain-free childbirth, simply by strongly suggesting to the mind that you will not feel pain, that you'll feel a negative emotion when you pick up a cigarette. It's basically attaching some sort of emotion subconsciously to either an action or, in the advertising industry's perspective, a product. Just as Simon Pegg forgot what he originally wanted, watch in this next clip how Darren Brown gets a group of people to forget the movie they just watched by using subliminal persuasion.
Can I have a look at where it says forget the film over the girl with the rose in her hair? I think that's a frame too long. Can we get that down to one frame?
Let's see how that works.
This is the Genesis Cinema in East London, which kindly agreed to include our ad amongst the trailers for a screening of Ocean's 12, a carefully chosen film which, if the ad works, the audience will not be able to remember. Not a bad thing. For legal reasons, patrons were told that some filming would happen, but our cameras were hidden in dark corners and people had no idea of the experiment. Obviously, I didn't expect the ad to make everyone forget the film, but I hoped a few would.
I just can't think of when.
Our cinema audience has now watched the film after absorbing my special ad. We stopped them on their way out to see what they could remember.
Why don't you tell me about the film you just saw?
It's a bit weird.
So how often do you go to cinema?
Don't go much, about once a month.
Is there a particular genre you like or don't like?
I like foreign movies.
Uh-huh. But yeah, this one you...
And I don't remember anything about the movie.
It's about a heist that goes wrong. And then it comes together because the guy's got a contact with his mother.
If I try to picture the actual scene, I see like a sieve. That's going to sound even worse, like just a sieve.
I remember the whole thing, yeah. Wicked. Awesome film.
I can only remember, like, casually, like, going into the cinema, and then, like, when we came out, my mind just went blank, and I don't know why.
I can't remember anything, man. I don't know why, I don't understand what's going on. It's like a block.
The bright lights, they put people in trances. If you go and you get a good stage production, and I've seen some of the best pastors and preachers down in Texas when I was living down there, I'd go to them, and even up in New York. And one of the things that they know in hypnosis is to have massive amounts of light up at an angle. So when you're looking up here in the visual cortex, and what it does is it kind of, in a sense, will blank the mind out. And it'll create points of focus for your nervous system and overwhelm it. And that's part of what hypnosis is to overwhelm your system.
If you've ever gone to a movie theater, you know that you sit in a dark room and you stare at bright lights. So just like Mark Ryan is saying that that can be a very hypnotic effect, you're also then flooding the system with so much information at one point in time that it's hard for your brain to process that much information. Your brain's like a computer, like a processor. It can only process a certain amount of information at one given time. And so when you flood it with too much information, you can go into a hypnotic state.
Well, with hypnosis, they're still trying to find out exactly what the mechanisms are that are working in the brain, but now with the neuroscience, they're really finding out fast. So there's an old saying we used in sales, and that was, you sell by emotions and you justify by logic. So the bottom line of basically NLP, any change work, any conditioning, any brainwashing, it goes down to emotions. You can just think, I'll just use something really basic. Think of something in your life that at one time you didn't believe in or didn't think about because you felt a certain way about it, and then you change that. Why was it? Because all of a sudden you got a different feeling, and that different feeling then started producing different pictures in your head, different internal dialogue, how you talk to yourself, and different feelings, and that together, enough of those forms a belief system, and that changes everything.
Why do you cry in movies? You know it's fake, you know it's a fictional story, you know the actors are pros who are trained to, can't help it. I mean, not everyone cries in every movie, but you know, there are certainly scenes where you're just like, oh, or great artwork, right? You go in the Louvre and you see, you know, whatever, Mona Lisa, or whatever it is, it's like so powerful, I'm having this big emotional experience.
We spoke to a group of college students who had all seen a particular movie called Fight Club. When we asked everyone in the room who had seen Fight Club, and this is at a Christian college, where in this movie do they speak about God? Only one person in the whole entire room could answer the question.
I want to ask a quick question. I have seen this movie probably 20 times, maybe more. This was one of my favorite films. How many people in this room have seen this movie? Look at how many hands just went up. Can somebody tell me in this movie where they speak about God? You got one person. What scene?
Out of everyone in the room who has a religious belief, only one person could remember the scene where they actually spoke about God. And here's what was said.
Our fathers were our models for God. If our fathers bailed, what does that tell you about God?
No,
listen to me. You have to consider the possibility that God does not like you. Never wanted you. In all probability, he hates you. This is not the worst thing that can happen.
It isn't.
We don't need him. We are God's unwanted children. So be it. Listen, you can run water over your hand to make it worse, or look at me, or you can use vinegar to neutralize the burn.
Please let me have it, please.
First, you have to give up. First, you have to know, not fear, know that someday you're gonna die. It's only after we've lost everything that we're free to do anything.
So think about this. In a room full of Christian believers, you have a movie that speaks very negatively about God, but nobody could remember it. Why? Because remember, the moral command center is bypassed, it's shut off. When you watch a film, you are reacting off of it, off of your limbic system, your emotional system, and so much information is coming in that you're not consciously thinking about the information as it's going into your brain. So that's how a whole room full of Christians would miss something like that. Take, for instance, the movie Avatar. Notice, while watching the trailer of Avatar, this is a real-time fMRI study of the brain. Look at how the frontal lobe activity is virtually shut off, and most of the activity is off the visual cortex or the limbic system in the rear of the brain. Just like marketers are starting to use fMRI brain scans to sell you their products, Hollywood is using fMRI brain scans to make better and better films that have a better emotional response. Recently, neuromarketing has shifted into neurocinema. Hollywood executives have commissioned neuroscientist Stephen Quartz at the California Institute of Technology to improve movie trailers. Quartz is best known for his discovery in the areas of the brain that are specifically associated with human anticipation and pleasure. Director Peter Katz is using fMRI technology to get a greater emotional response from his audience.
With neurocinema technology, filmmakers can now look inside your mind to make better movies. I'm Peter Katz. I'm a film producer. Studios rely on people to accurately fill out questionnaires after a test screening. The problem is, it's difficult to remember specific details of a film and what you felt about each scene. We will scan the brain of our test subject, Bridget. She's going to watch my horror film, Popsicle, set a fMRI machine to measure her fear. Bridget will watch two scenes in a Siemens 3T MRI. The data from the scan will be converted into a real-time view of Bridget's amygdala and other regions of her brain to be analyzed by the team.
Okay, we're gonna get started, Bridget.
Okay.
Are you doing okay?
Yeah.
All right, here we go. What we're looking for, the amygdala, is right here. So after we analyze this in about 2 weeks, we are hoping to see activation here, the amygdala.
So you could see fear. Like if she's scared, like if she's actually scared, you could see that right on the brain.
The amygdala controls fear,
yeah,
anger, rage, anything that's fight or flight. So if she's having any of those emotions, I think that's pretty good for a horror film.
At the Topanga Film Festival in Southern California, a number of neuromarketing features were offered. Seven neuroscientists discussed film imagery and its effect on our conscious and subconscious processes in our brains.
Notice how everything is centered around your emotions. Remember what Mark Ryan said, if you want to do any change work, it's all centered around your emotions. Remember what the neuromarketer said, emotions is the key.
Not only are filmmakers tracking what the brain is doing, but new technology has created an opportunity to see exactly what the eyes are looking at on the big screen. This has opened up the door for filmmakers to hide even more things in the background because they're tracking what you'll be looking at throughout the film.
Imagine a day when people have this headset at home connected to an iPhone and are doing interesting things, not just getting their brains measured while watching advertising or content, but even do more interesting things, like if content can change based on how they feel.
With all of this new technology that's coming out and this fMRI brain scan studies, Hollywood is talking about changing the frame rates because they want you to be more emotionally invested into the films.
Well, we were able to monitor electrocardiogram, electroencephalogram, galvanic skin response, electromyogram, and mapped out how people responded physiologically to increases in frame rate.
Right.
Had nothing to do with content, performance, framing, directing, acting, anything. And we found out there was this perfect bell-shaped curve that just got better and better and better. People got more and more excited, up around 60, 66, 72 frames a second. Because okay, when you get into an immersive experience like this, it's like you're in the movie, not looking at a movie. You become a participant in the movie like a theme park ride.
Technology matters because it enables you, our valued customer, to live the dream that unfolds on this screen more intensely, exactly the way the director had in mind. Lately, we've seen some important new technologies emerge in cinema theaters, and today, we're about to take the next big step. Peter Jackson, James Cameron, and several other important filmmakers have decided to shoot their new projects in 48 frames per second. Now, what does this mean? Since the 1920s and still today, films are being projected at a speed of 24 frames per second. And that's perfect, until the camera moves. See how the image during the movement is blurred. This is why director Peter Jackson decided to shoot his new epic movie, The Hobbit, in a much faster 48 frames per second. This creates a hyper-realistic film experience for the audience.
But the idea of real in cinema, as in, you know, because Pandora...
It's meaningless now.
Exactly.
The idea of what's real.
We're experimenting right now with 30-foot Lamberts in 3D, which is unheard of,
yes,
at 120 frames a second, which is unheard of. And the result is an experience that is so close to reality that it calls for a whole new cinematic language.
Another trend that's happening is they're wanting to increase your experience at the theater. They came out with this whole new thing called D-Box seats.
It is called D-Box, and it's set to cause quite a sensation.
It's being tried out at a theater in Hollywood.
D-Box will open for the public on April 3rd.
One thing that surprised me was how much the seat felt more than just like a ride at Disney. It felt like the whole thing was tuned into every part of your body when you were sitting there watching the movie.
I really enjoyed how it made me feel like I was in the movie.
You're actually in the movie.
In the movie.
As if I was in the scene myself.
As cinematic technology advances with one purpose, to increase your emotional involvement, what if particular filmmakers were fully aware of how our minds work? Could they use hypnotic tactics to deliver a deeper message in a film? By changing the frame rates and the use of experience-enhancing technology such as the D-Box seats, could they be manipulating our emotions to mold our belief systems? If the content is tested and honed by fMRI studies to tailor the films for maximum effect, could this medium be used to implant ideas into our subconscious? After all, there must be a reason why they call it programming. Are movies using the same tactics of psychology and hypnosis in their storylines? If our minds are in alpha state and highly suggestible during a movie, what kinds of messages are we allowing into our subconscious? If someone could forget a film simply because it was suggested for them to do so, could someone develop negative feelings about God simply because it was suggested to them? Mark Ryan has taken notice of the use of hypnosis in certain films.
Now let's talk about something really, really important here, and that's the conscious, what we call the critical factor, those seven plus or minus two pieces of information. The critical factor is what you were taught as a child growing up when you said, don't run out into the road. You want them to stay in the driveway, look both ways before they go across the street. So you've got all this stuff set up by your parents, by your teachers, by your community to protect you, to make you safe. And what we're looking for in hypnosis, what TV, what commercials are looking to do is to interrupt that process. They want you to get past the critical factor is what it's called. Yeah, in the movie Inception, they used a lot of time distortion. Time distortion in hypnosis and NLP is huge. Again, people can follow time for so long, the seven plus or minus two, before they lose it, and then they can't keep track of time. So back to television, back to the movies, when you start to have a belief change or you think it's a certain way and you say, hey, don't watch that or don't do that yourself, people go, nah. They have reasons, a whole bunch of them, just like with the shoe and sock, of why they can't be hypnotized. So as in a movie, like the Inception, when you're playing with time and you're playing with time distortion, now you can, and if you notice, they went to different levels of time. And that's what I was talking about in the video that you saw. They go to different levels of time, then they close it off. Now they got the cognitive dissonance, they got the memories. So they're not only taking the movie through it, they're taking you through it. I mean, I had to go back and search to remember about the old Chinese guy. I mean, you forget about him because they open a loop, they close a loop, they open another loop, multiple embedded loops. And then you'll have amnesia for them. So what you want to do as a hypnotherapist when you're doing it on the positive side is to get people into those trance. Open so many of them, don't close them, you open them. You open them on one side, you start to tell a story, you don't finish a story, you go into another story. You start telling a story, you don't finish a story, you go into another story. And then when you get at the core, and the core of the Inception movie was what? They got this guy to go into the room with his father in a made-up scenario about what was going to happen to the father. So now if you engage the imagination at that point, that depth of trance, there's no critical factor there. There's nothing blocking from anything you can put in there. So if you could change people's feelings, that changes beliefs, that changes convictions. They'll do all kinds of different things, which the guy in the movie did. But what did they have to first do? The belief that held it, and that's why they had the psychologist there, the belief that held it together was that his father did something nasty to him as he was dying.
I know you were disappointed. I couldn't be you. No. I was disappointed. But you tried.
But when they found out really he was doing something beautiful to him, what did he change? It was his emotions that changed. It was like, I gotta look at it differently now.
If you're in the deepest state of hypnosis during this scene, then what message could they be leaving into your subconscious? There are tons of Gnostic websites that herald this movie as a brilliant retelling of the Gnostic faith, an inverting of the Bible and making God evil and Satan good. Some of our other documentaries explain the Gnostic faith in more detail, but for now, let's consider what the whole Inception movie is all about. A thief who uses deception to help a young businessman realize something about his father that he never knew before. The Bible also speaks about a thief who used deception to suggest something about a father. The director Christopher Nolan gained his inspiration for this movie from Philip K. Dick, the father of postmodernism and Gnosticism in today's pop culture. If you just type Inception and Gnosticism into Google, it won't take long to see what religion this movie is really teaching.
So let's just shut everything down and let's think about this logically. Look at how just by turning off these monitors in the background, how much less information your brain has had to process. A lot of people want to say that it's just entertainment and that it doesn't affect you. But after what you've just seen, it's really hard to say that.
Just think about all the movies that you've ever seen that has the same elements of hypnosis that Mark Ryan has just described. Time distortion, goofy random images, multiply embedded storylines that intersect at some given point. Couple that with your heightened state of emotion and an alpha brainwave pattern, and it becomes a recipe for manipulating your subconscious. The films that you most like are the ones that you identify with. Why? Because you place yourself in those characters' shoes. What they experience, you vicariously experience. What they feel, you feel. What they believe, you believe. If your favorite heroes are fighting against God, guess what? You also might be fighting against God.
Now that we see that science proves that entertainment actually does affect you, the entertainment that is coming out of Hollywood does have a profound effect upon your mind.
Let's look at the big picture. Your frontal lobe is being bypassed, so you're not critically analyzing the information that's going into your brain. You're not compartmentalizing it anyway because you're only thinking with the right side of your brain, so the information is coming into your memory as one big chunk. If there's rapid sequencing and the frame rates are such, there's a hypnotic effect that's taking place. So you're in this heightened state of suggestibility. Even if you don't believe in God, you have to recognize that this thing is very powerful in terms of changing your mind, of implanting a memory, of ultimately affecting the way you behave and the way you act in the world.
Is it possible that we are in the middle of a great war against good and evil? What if there is a war between God and Satan? So if these directors and if these writers have a belief system that is fighting against Christ, fighting against God, they could be using this technology to implant ideas, implant belief systems into people using a non-threatening way of entertainment.
Let me give you a little inside information about God. He's an absentee landlord. Worship that? Never.
Better to reign in hell than serve in heaven, is that it?
Why not?
If you could be either God's worst enemy or nothing, which would you choose? We're the middle children of history. We have no special purpose or place, and unless we get God's attention, we have no hope of damnation or redemption. Which is worse, hell or nothing?
I absolutely believe in God. And I absolutely hate the
f***. You ask me if I have a God complex? Let me tell you something. I am God.
And what we see across the board is an attack on God, an attack on his character, and a promotion of the postmodern view of the relativity of right and wrong.
I love the saying, by beholding, we become changed. And I really believe that. The more we behold these things around us, scientifically shows us that we will become changed. We will become more like what we view, what we listen to. That's why it's so important to be careful what you put into your mind. If you're watching various films that fight against God or change the storyline to make you believe that God is evil or angry, that has a profound effect upon your belief system.
So God speaks to us through our mind. The Bible is very clear that he dwells in us, and more specifically, on a scientific level, it's through our frontal lobe. And if you think about it logically, if that portion of our brain is bypassed, are we bypassing what God is trying to say to us? Are you letting Hollywood crowd out the voice of God? It would do us well to dwell on things that are pure and holy, that Paul penned in Philippians 4:8. If we behold God's character in His love and mercy, our characters will be transformed in that likeness.
For most of the past century, society has been part of a grand experiment in entertainment and advertising. If pseudology is lying considered as an art form, then think about the world's first lie. It transformed the individual's worldview and who they were created in the image of God. It deceitfully gave a glimmer of a higher status, yet ultimately created a void. In the 1920s, when advertising shifted from meeting a customer's need by simply stating the product's facts and function, to selling products based on wants, desires, and an emotion, a lie was told to society. You are not complete, you are not beautiful enough, and you do not matter. What you own and how you look defines you. Martin Luther King dreamed of a day that the content of a character would define every individual. Yet advertising has effectively sold you a lie that possessions and appearance define your individual self-worth. Similarly, think about the entertainment industry. Instead of selling you a product, are they selling you a set of ideas or a worldview? Simply consider all the programming that you've watched or are currently watching. What kind of picture is this painting into your character? Is it possible that the devil, the author of deception, has influenced, suggested, and guided some of the most popular stories to propagate his lies about God's character? Everyone knows the entertainment industry is one of the most influential businesses on the planet, and that it has the power to form or conform social attitudes, beliefs, and worldviews. Your entertainment choices today will, in fact, impact your life tomorrow.
Thank you.